All right, good evening, everyone. Today's date is Tuesday, November 21st, 2017. It is 7:32 p.m., and I hereby call this meeting of the Bedford School Committee to order. To do so, we'll begin with a roll call vote. Ms. Gray.
Present.
Ms. Santiago.
Present.
And I am present. I have a quorum having been met. I also want to say hello to Leslie Ann, a senior class of 18, joining us tonight. Leslie, thank you for being here. I will begin, as we always do, with comments from the public. Do we have a public willing to make comments? Seeing none, we will move on to the next item on our agenda, which is the personnel report. Mr. Sills.
Okie doke. We have a few individual leaves of absence and appointments to mention, and then a field trip to review. So Tammy McGagan is going on maternity leave, special educator for JJMS, and she will be replaced as a long-term basis by Kimberly Lamoli at JGMS, and then we had a second opening for an interim special education teacher, and we've hired Allison Wardwell. Allison comes to us with some experience from North Andover Public Schools after having earned her BA in elementary education from Endicott College and an MA in school counseling from Salem State.
And is that an interim position that was because of another resignation?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Just making sure. All right, is that it for the...
That's it.
Oh, then
the
we have out-of-state field trip.
Yeah. So we discussed this briefly before, and there were some questions that the school committee had. I had as well. This is a field trip that Julia Herman and Jamie Nolan have organized, involved several other teachers. From the Lane School. They've made some adjustments to this field trip, and I'm actually very excited and very supportive of it at this point. So the purpose of this trip is to take fifth graders who are our Medco students in fifth grade and to give them a chance to pair with Bedford students whom they feel connected with, students of any background in Bedford, and have them spend some time doing some leadership training in the wilderness with the hope that they can really solidify some relationships that tend to really get strained historically as kids matriculate from fifth grade into middle school. And so Mr. Tracy is looking forward, and Akhil, our Medco director, are looking forward to then picking us up in sixth grade and doing some work in sixth grade with this group. To try to nurture and sustain, deepen these relationships. So this is really about creating connections and addressing an issue that we've identified where many of our students from Boston do well academically but may not feel as connected socially to Bedford. And that social connection is not only important for the lives of kids for whom that's important, but also in the end has an impact on their academics. So I think you'll notice the modification they made. Kids will identify somebody that they feel close to, and then there'll be a process of speaking with the parents and identifying for sure whether parents are interested in what the long-term purpose of this is.
Okay. So I will accept the motion from any member of the committee to approve an out-of-state field trip to Mount Carrigan Lodge in Alexandria, New Hampshire, from 5/31/18 to 6/1/18, at a total cost to the school per pupil at $0, and a total cost to the school of. You know the price?
I'm sorry.
That's right. I think I saw it in here before. I guess we can just go with the total cost to the pupil at $0.
Yes,
and the rest to be covered by the
Medco grant.
Yeah. From any member of the committee.
So moved.
Ann moves. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Do I have a second? Ann, we'll start with you. Any questions?
It's nice to see that some changes have been made, and maybe I'm overthinking this one. So the idea is that a fifth grader will pick another friend to go along?
A Bedford friend, yes.
Are we going to be causing any social anxiety in school with who you picked and didn't get picked and who gets to go and doesn't?
I think there certainly are those potential ramifications. I trust that these professionals will be paying close attention to that. I think inevitably, in social situations that are not 100% inclusive, you're going to have some potential fallout. Mm-hmm.
I think the goal is a good one, and I'm not sure how to implement it any other way, but I do have that concern. And then they'll miss 2 days of school towards the end of the year?
Yes.
Any other questions?
No.
Joanne, any questions?
I have the same concerns, or maybe a little bit different. I'm just concerned about the hurt feelings if a child nominates another child who either doesn't want to go or another child wants to go and doesn't get picked and feels slighted. So the mechanics of that piece may be a little bit uncomfortable. But otherwise, I think that the goal of the program to develop leadership skills and strengthen bond between the students is a very good one.
No, as you raise these questions, there may be a way to kind of mask that. Mm-hmm. By doing some homework and then doing some kind of a lottery where it appears that it's kind of by chance.
Right.
So I appreciate that feedback, and I'll share that with the staff members.
And just one, I should have thought about this. Will the family, I mean, are we sure the families would want to do this? The Metro families?
No, not until they're given the opportunity. I mean, okay. This all depends on doing the educational piece and
all right. I'm trusting that the adults can handle the social difficulties, and it seems to me like kind of an interesting idea. So I guess my interest would be in having them report back how it went, just because it's new, and I think sometimes we have to take a chance on something new. It's certainly well-staffed, and important people are going, responsible people, so I feel comfortable in approving it, but I'd just be curious to see. Let's give it a chance this year and see how it looks. And then I'd love to hear the feedback on it when they get back. And to see, as they enter sixth grade, whether those bonds really are strengthened or whether there's a different way to do that. So I'm with Joanne. I think the purpose of it is right, and I think the idea is good. So with that, we'll take a roll call vote. A voice vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, say no. Any abstentions? That is approved 3-0. Anything else for the personnel report? That is it. Up next, Mr. Morrissey, grade 6 through 12 math program presentation. I want to thank Ms. Galante for being here as well. You're supporting Mr. Morrissey and all things mathematics related. Thank you for taking time out of your evening to do it. Mr. Morrissey, you're on.
Okay, thank you. My name is Patrick Morrissey. I'm the program administrator for John Glenn Middle School and also for the high school. Last month, I was here with three other students to talk about the calculus project. Thank you for having me back to talk about our vision, department strengths, and some challenges ahead. So first, the vision for all math courses at John Glenn Middle School and at Bedford High School is for all students to develop both the mathematical skills and the conceptual understanding of our math standards. Our classrooms at all levels will have productive struggle, require transfer of essential prior knowledge, and a focus on vocabulary. Our lessons are based around rich mathematical tasks that make students think and ask questions, helping students to develop the habits of mind and the higher order thinking skills to be able to persevere in solving tasks is subject of ongoing work in the math department and is at the heart of the Common Core standards of mathematical practice, which I'll discuss later. The screenshot you see here on the right-hand side is from the sixth grade MCAS 2.0 in 2017. This is an open response problem, was worth 4 points, and you'll notice a few things about it. Number one, there aren't too many numbers in this problem. You'll notice that in three of the four parts, students are asked to show or explain their work. The text, even for a sixth grader, seems somewhat dense and requires a close reading in order to make sense of it. Students need to be skilled at gleaning information from a data table. And also notice, for these sixth graders, they're not the typical X and Y variables. I think it's N and N and P, talking about profit. So it goes without saying this was a rich task for a sixth grader. Our kids earned about 80% of the points on this question, where the state average was about 12%. And tonight I'll talk just a little bit about the MCAS, not very much, but I wanted to point out that even just with this problem, it shows that in our district, our focus on disciplinary literacy, just that's starting this year, is well timed, since we need to give all students meaningful opportunities to, in problems like this, or just in tasks in classroom in general, meaningful opportunities to read and to write and to really engage in discussion with their peers, and then ultimately do the work independently themselves in order to be able to tackle tasks like this on tests like the MCAS, on tests in their classes and beyond. So that's sort of the overarching vision of our math department. And a few strengths that I just want to highlight and talk a little bit about before we go into the challenges would be our work that we did with learning expectations at Bedford High School this past year, or past about 2 years. Our growing AP Calculus enrollment and our scores, the growing enrollment in Geometry High Honors, and then, as we talked about last month with the three students that were here, our Calculus Project program, which I won't talk about tonight really, but I wanted to put it out because I am pretty proud of that work. So first, the objective-based learning expectations. So being explicit about exactly what we want students to know and be able to do in our courses has been important work that our teachers have undertaken in both schools. Our learning expectations by course and by level at the high school, and what you see here on this slide, which I'll talk about, was a major effort, I think, to be transparent with students and parents and other teachers and support staff about what we want students to learn in our courses. Last year, we finished the unit-by-unit objectives for all major courses, and they're posted now on our website. I'm very proud of the work that the teachers work in getting these documents, completed. Since we've only really had them internally, and use them internally, or sometimes not at all in some courses. So they're based on the Massachusetts standards that incorporate the Common Core for Algebra 1, Geometry, Algebra 2, and then for our pre-calculus and our calculus courses, we based the work on the College Board standards. So on the left-hand side, I just have cut two examples. On the left-hand side, you see something from our Geometry course. It says Geometry High Honors, but the unhighlighted objectives are for all levels, College Prep, Honors, and High Honors. The yellow highlights are for Honors and High Honors only, and then blue is for High Honors only. On the right, you see objectives from our Pre-Calculus Honors course. This month, for example, a little anecdote, the three Pre-Calculus Honors teachers sent me their test on exponential functions and logarithms, this is the unit objectives for that unit. And they wanted feedback on how the test was looking. And so my first instinct and what I did was I went on the website, printed out this expectations, and I checked to see where the questions lined up to what we told the students we wanted them to learn. And the test was very much in line with not only what I had seen in class, but what was on this document. And so I believe when students take assessments in our department at Bedford High School that are standards-based, I think it really goes a long way to strengthening our program. Next, for AP Calculus. So Mr. Venkatesh for many years taught BC Calculus, and now Ms. Faulkner and I have been the teachers in AP Calculus, and we've had some pretty strong results, which I've shared with you before. And I think we've had those strong results because we've been mindful of the standards assessed by the College Board, we've prepared strong lessons, and we've given students opportunities that are rich in writing, reading, and making oral arguments. So this three-pronged approach, I believe, and I'll talk about tonight, needs to be applied in all classes. I'll expand on that in my last slide. I took over from Mr. Venkatesh in 2016, 2 years ago, and he's been a mentor to me for the BC curriculum, which is quite rigorous. And Ms. Faulkner is in her fourth year of teaching AP Calculus. Last year, if you look at this table, we had 28 students in BC Calculus, average of 4.64. And 31 students in AB Calculus, average of 3.8. And I want you to know that just about every single student who takes our calculus course takes the exam in May. So the scores that we have are really a true representation of what we had in front of the kids that are in our class. Our next major challenge as a department is going to be taking on, where Department 6 through 12 will be working on ensuring we're teaching the updated math standards for MCAS 2.0 and teaching through the lens of the 8 standards of mathematical practice, which at their core are all about math literacy. The way that we prepare for this for AP calculus can serve as a model for our department for how we can prepare all kids for the MCAS. Next, so another strength, so geometry high honors, which I'm going to talk about tonight, but here's our first slide on it. Concerning that class, there has been much work undertaken in the last year and a half between both buildings, the middle school and the high school, for this course. And one positive that I see is that the number of students that are entering geometry high honors is growing. The calculus project, which we talked about last month, is just a small part of this growth. So year of graduation 2020, there were 7 students as a part of the calculus project who were in geometry high honors, 2 of whom were here last month. In addition to the calculus project, the two-building effort has allowed our numbers to grow, although with a small dip. You can see this year, 2021, there are just 33 students. But if you note, at the bottom of the slide, the 5-year average prior to the last 3 years, the average was about 29 students in geometry high honor. So even this small class in 2021 has more students on average. Take note that in 2016 to 2017, so last year, there were 47 students in the class, which is a 62% increase over the 5-year average that's mentioned on the slide. And only 4 kids switched levels. So kids sort of moving from high honors to honors is something that we're really trying to work on in terms of getting placements right. Last year, only 4 kids switched levels. This past summer, in terms of geometry high honors, I included a parent on our hiring committee. We were hiring a new teacher. And I had a parent on our hiring committee for the sort of the normal rounds. And then we had a student panel for the sort of the second round. And the teacher who we were hiring would be teaching geometry high honors. And it was a way for me to include the parent and the student voice in this like vital process. If you look at the last bullet, which is most exciting, next year we're projecting, and I've double checked this with the teachers at the middle school. Next year we're projecting 70 to 80 students to be enrolled in geometry high honors. That's 3 sections of the course, which we've never had before. It's completely unprecedented. We'll come back to geometry high honors in a minute. So those are some strengths and positives and accomplishments, plus the calculus project, which I've already briefed you on. Now we're moving on to challenges and some action steps. So in 2016 in May, I presented to you, and some of the challenges at that time included the beginning of an audit of geometry high honors, especially the assessments, addressing the pay tutoring issue, and wondering if our MCAS tours were a new trend or just a momentary dip. So first, geometry high honors, returning to it. Here on this slide, you're gonna see three years of averages since I've been department head, ranging from a C+ to a solid B. In the 5 years previous, I mentioned that the average class size was 29 students. It didn't say on the last slide what the average grade was. So the average grade in the 5 previous years was a solid B. It was about 84, sometimes 83, 85, in that sort of range. So this was during a time when we only had BC Calculus. We didn't have AB Calculus as a course. And so Geometry High Honors was considered a very, very challenging course reserved for only the brightest math minds coming out of the middle school. I'm saying either most, if not all, of the students came from what we used to call the pull-out math class. And that was the class that did a lot of sort of tangential, really far out there math topics. I personally taught many students in AB Calculus and BC Calculus the last 3 years, and then students in Algebra 2 High Honors, or we used to call Level 5 when I was first hired, students who intentionally bypassed the Geometry High Honors course because they had heard it was extraordinarily difficult. I want to point out on this slide that the increase from 26 students to 47 students between 2020 and 2019, we only did see a 2% drop in the overall averages. Though, in conversations I've had with six area high school department heads, department leaders, whatever you want to call them, the averages that, oh, and actually, hold on, before I say that, the schools that I talked to, all proficient or higher, better than we have been typically doing, so like really high-achieving schools. I found that our course averages in our highest honors classes were very comparable when the department heads reported. But in geometry high honors, you can see we had, there's a C+, but then solid Bs. Most of the schools were the bare minimum was about a solid B. Like that was, you know, that was sort of the my overall takeaway. And some of the averages were B+. So my message last year to the teacher in geometry high honors was there wasn't much difference between an ideal average and what we were actually doing. So we were close, but changes needed to be made in order to make the class more accessible to more students. So some of the work that we've done in geometry high honors over the past year and a half have included updating review sheets, swapping out proofs that were from year to year we knew students were going to struggle on, adding questions from the honors exams, because you saw in that learning expectation that there's overlap between honors and high honors, college prep, honors, high honors. Adding in more regular checks for understanding, adding extra review sessions, designing in the moment algebra skills work, reworking the notes to add in more challenge, improving the visual supports of the actual problems, adding justification sheets, and then a lot of the work that we were doing with the kids in the calculus project during the X block, we were making a lot of new materials, and so we would, toward the end of the year, the kids would not only come into the X block and sort of, you know, hang out with us, but they, you know, we would offer the materials that we had for all kids to use. So we did a lot to make this course more accessible. Making the course Geometry High Honors not a barrier for students is in line this year with our school improvement plan's goal that's focused on the transition between our two buildings. The quote, I'll give you a second to read it at the bottom of the screen, is from an eighth grade teacher who's talking about a student who's on the cusp of Geometry High Honors and Honors. So this is a student who really, you know, in my opinion, should have been in Geometry High Honors, but wasn't. After personally leading the review of this entire course, I see how much rich and important algebra work there is in the course. And students who bypass this course are at a disadvantage if they enroll in Algebra 2 High Honors the next year. I rewatched some of the videos on YouTube from when I was here with the Calculus Project kids, and Jazzy mentioned that. In terms of even though it was a tough year for her last year, she realized that the work that we did with algebra really boosted her confidence and improved her overall math ability because she was in Geometry High Honors. Last year, during some of our valuable joint 6 through 12 department meeting time, we took time to audit the tasks and assessments that are given at the middle school in Algebra 1. We had problem-solving sessions where teachers worked together solving rich tasks on factoring and ratios, which are two topics that span the entire curriculum, grades 6 through 12. Last year, the 8th grade teachers observed 9th grade teachers for an entire day here at the high school to get an idea of the expectations that were expected of kids in freshman courses. The 9th and 8th grade teachers collaborated on an algebra skills packet that formed the basis of a sort of like a summer assignment for kids leaving Algebra 1 and coming to the high school. And, you know, that sort of assignment gave kids and teachers a clear idea of what the expectations were, and the expectations are quite high in this course in freshman year. This year, now, 2017-2018, we have the 8th grade teachers in their goals, in their professional goals, working to align the Algebra 1 curriculum with the academically advanced math curriculum in the areas of challenge and expectations. So some language from their goals, it says, we're incorporating higher level thinking into Algebra 1 tasks, including written explanations. Our vision is for Algebra 1, the 8th grade algebra class, to be at the level of the academically advanced math class, and extra topics that are covered in the advanced section, the academically advanced math, would only be sort of exploratory in nature and not necessarily helpful for future classes. As I mentioned, we're expecting 70 to 80 students in Geometry High Honors. this is a huge and exciting change for me, and I'm hopeful that the work in both buildings that's been done and that is ongoing will help the course be more accessible to, you know, for more students. This is really important. We still have high expectations in this course, and the teachers work with the students to meet them. Next, tutoring for pay. This was a hot button topic with other schools. So I talked to you about this a year and a half ago. In talking with five area department heads, it's widely suspected that tutoring is just, you know, rampantly, I mean, is very popular. A school nearby shared with me that their pay tutoring list had 40 names on it. Ours, it says here, has 6. I had a person email me today, so it is technically 7. But we have 7 active tutors on our list. One math leader, I have a quote here, told me, and these are again from the high-performing districts, some families hire a tutor because even before taking advantage of extra help, which is surprising. Another department head wrote, it's almost a status symbol for students to have a tutor, and it really causes a lot of problems. Students will say in class, I get it now, but I'll just ask my tutor later. A teacher at BHS yesterday and another department head emailed me saying students would even ask to postpone tests because they were meeting with their tutor later in the week. One department head used the word secretive to talk about tutors, and I've often sensed that to some extent here at Bedford High School, where students just don't openly talk about whether or not they see a tutor. Another department head shared that his school, much like ours, which I'll talk about on the next slide, has an academic achievement center where students can get help, but mostly for sort of like the entry-level college prep kind of courses. And so that, you know, that very comment from another school was the reason, the impetus behind us trying to get volunteer tutors for, you know, for drop-in help here at BHS. Last year we had volunteer tutors help mostly in pre-calculus and calculus. When I would look at the sign-in sheet and see what students were coming and what topics they were looking for, it was mostly pre-calculus and calculus. That started last April. We currently have volunteer tutors during lunch block and during flex block, and I will advocate for more volunteer tutoring during different parts of the day. One anecdote I figured I would share with you, which I thought was quite sweet, was there was a student who came to Bedford High School, say, beginning of October. So the student had come from hurricane-ravaged Puerto Rico, and she needed help with functions. And typically, during our flex block, you know, teachers have, you know, 2 or 3 or 4 kids potentially that they're working with. And so this student was able to get help from one of our tutors on functions, and it was sort of, you know, one-on-one kind of attention that was, you know, if that could happen on a more regular basis, it would be fantastic. Because right now, quarter-one grades have been posted, and we have kids that are struggling. And I'm not here saying that the volunteer program is going great, because there are days when no kids show up, but there's a lot of potential in this program, and it's worked quite a bit this year, so I'm very hopeful for it. But then there are days when no kids show up. So next, academic support. The need for academic support is a common, you know, from my research and talking with other schools, it's a common issue at basically all schools. So how some schools are doing academic support in Concord and Brookline, I'm told that math teachers teach 4 classes, and their 5th class is used to essentially staff a drop-in center during the school day. Concord also has a sort of a drop-in place for kids to do makeup tests. Note that in Concord also, during the sort of the drop-in times that's staffed by math teachers, it's a time for students, especially those in special ed, to sort of push in for extra help on sort of a coordinated basis. Schools like Acton and Newton South told me they have centers that are staffed with volunteers, with students, and teaching assistants. Here at Bedford High School, we have our Academic Achievement Center led by Lisa Morrison. In terms of math support, we have a half-time Title I math support teacher who works on days 1, 2, and 3 on a 6-day cycle, who's focused on our most struggling students, and honestly, you know, toward the MCAS for sure, remediation with math skills that are targeted toward the MCAS, and we're glad to have her. There's also a drop-in math center where students from independent study and other courses, or you know, special ed learning centers, for example, can come and get help during the school day. And we're hopeful that we can make that a more coordinated effort. It's something that Lisa Morrison has started doing, which I think has some promise. Other sort of, in terms of general support for math at the high school, we have quite a bit. So I mentioned the volunteer tutors. They're available during lunch and flex blocks. During flex block, just really briefly, all of our teachers are available for extra help. I am working with teachers on being more proactive, to, you know, inviting kids to come see them during flex block. Speaking personally, having teachers focused on just academics and not having sort of a divided duty between academics and clubs and activities, I think has been a positive change for us. We have 38 students enrolled in our math lab class, so a 0.2 FTE worth of a math teacher's workload. That's our math lab that I, you know, briefly mentioned last time with the Calculus Project kids. Of those 38 kids, for example, there's 6 students in our Calculus Project who are in Algebra 2 High Honors. I will definitely advocate for additional math lab sections, as they will allow a wide array of students, some with real gaps in their knowledge, to receive a general education support from one of our math teachers. The math lab class is something Lisa Morrison and I proposed 2 years ago, and it's in its second year and seems to be growing every year, which is fantastic. Let's see, just one more. So I meant the Academic Achievement Center under Lisa Morrison's leadership is supporting 159 students, an array of supports, not just all math, but math is a big part of it. And it's overseen by the Academic Achievement Center teacher. So, you know, overview of our supports, and thank you for your continued support. Now, MCAS, dip or a trend. I'm not here to give a full report on MCAS. Mary Lou is going to do that later this year. But I want to share just a couple pieces of data that I've been able to glean from the MCAS results at the high school. So we had 91% proficient or advanced, which has been the same for the past 3 years. Looking at this chart here, I'm definitely going to give you time to process this. So there's 15 names, or not names, there's 15 lines that represent a student on this chart. 13 needs improvement, and 2 students that did not pass, that failed. So 10 of the 15 students were 5 or fewer points away from proficient. Let's look at the green column, column M. Green column shows the students in our school, in our high school, that were the sort of the lowest achieving students. If you take, for example, look at the opportunity for, I'm going to give you an example in a second, but look at the opportunities for points from free response, the essay questions. There's 6 essay questions, open response questions, like the one I shared from sixth grade at the beginning of the presentation. So the points that were available for the students to potentially earn that they did not earn are listed in column N. So if you take, for example, look at student 6 in row 6. So student in row 6, this student who was in Algebra 1 scored needs improvement. This student was 4 points or 4 questions away from being proficient. And so if you look at even just, if we were to focus on the open response questions, that student, if that student had averaged 2 out of 4, like usually the first question is sort of is on the easier side, and the second question is on the medium side. If that student had scored a 2, a 2, a 2, and a 2, just in those 4 questions would have been proficient. So I'm not even talking about multiple choice or other kinds of questions that are on the MCAS. So that's just one example. My point here is that many of our students this year that were needs improvement were not that far from proficient. Also, not displayed on this slide, 37 students that took geometry college prep, and 30 of them were proficient or advanced. So that's 81%. So of the class that we typically think of kids who would be apt to struggle the most on the MCAS, 81% of them were proficient or advanced. So I think those are two very positive data points. The fact that there's 10 people on this list right here who were close to proficient, and then that there are 81%, 30 out of 37 students in college prep geometry who were proficient or advanced. Okay, a couple more points. Year of graduation 2020, current sophomores, three of the kids were here last week with us, or last month with us. This is gonna be the first class that's had Algebra 1 or Algebra 1A, our two algebra courses at John Glenn Middle School. There's 138 sophomores in either Algebra 2 Honors or Algebra 2 High Honors this year. That's 65% of the sophomore class. Those kids will all be proficient or advanced, and the vast majority advanced on the MCAS, at least in this last round of legacy MCAS at the high school. Next year, this coming in 2018, is the last year that we're going to have the MCAS we've had the last 15 years or so. So I think this is another positive related to the MCAS, but in terms of having so many kids in Algebra 2 as sophomores. But we do also need to be mindful of, are we pushing some kids too much? And so to be monitoring their grades and monitoring their progress closely. This year, teachers in Algebra 1 College Prep and Geometry College Prep, typically the kids who would be apt to most struggle on the MCAS and potentially not be proficient, those teachers, in concert with a special education teacher, they're working in their PLC, in their team, they're focused on MCAS open response kinds of problems as their focused professional goal. In AP Calculus, that's all we do. Leslie, you'll tell them we've done so many questions this year, and we'll do probably like 30 more in AP Calculus open response. We did one today, and so I'm hoping that prepping the kids for open response questions in MCAS, in college prep. Algebra 1 and geometry, something we've never really done, I think has a potential to improve student learning and improve our MCAS scores. This work is also focused on teaching and practicing the skills of reading the dense texts, expressing your thinking in concise and precise mathematical sentences. Also, in college prep classes, we have some of our strongest and most seasoned teachers. I think this is all positive. Let's go back to the chart. Looking at this chart, under J, column J, math course 10th grade. If you look at that chart, there's 6 students who did not take geometry in 10th grade. Those students were very likely to earn at most needs improvement. So the ones that say Algebra 1, STEM, M. And so those are the students that are at most, you could say, needs improvement is that could be potentially the highest that they could get. And that is an ongoing challenge for us in terms of the MCAS. So giving all students access to grade level content, when we say grade level content, we don't mean Algebra 2 by sophomore year. If we say grade level content is Algebra 1 and geometry. So giving all students grade level content, Algebra 1 and geometry, is sort of a minimum bar. And something we're exploring for a potential new course or modifications to existing courses for some of the students that you would see potentially on this list. This year, we have 2 co-taught sections of Algebra 1. Typically, we've only had one. And in geometry, we have 1 co-taught section. We don't have 2 co-taught sections in algebra because we have more kids. It's just we thought it was something that would be helpful to all students. There will be likely some students who are not ready for grade level work, not ready for Algebra 1 and not ready for geometry as sophomores. For example, a student who might be in the STEM class or maybe our math applications class, but they should be the rare exceptions. But for them, it's important for you guys, for all of us to remember that for those students, if their needs improvement, that means they pass the MCAS, and that is a massive graduation hurdle, whatever you want to say, behind them. And so our goal has to be that we want 100% of our students as a bare minimum to take geometry and algebra. If we do that and we focus as a department on some things I'm going to talk about as I conclude, I think there's a lot of positives that can happen. But just keep in mind that some of our kids getting needs improvement, like we should be celebrating that some of them, that is like, they're gonna graduate from high school. I've said to Heather that it's quite possible I could, you know, Dan isn't here, I had written down he's sort of a numbers guy. I was ready to, I could predict what I think potentially the MCAS scores are just based on what courses kids are taking right now, which is sort of scary. And the crucial factor being, were they in Algebra 1 and Geometry? So if you look, to reinforce that, look, I think this is the last time I referenced this chart. Look at row 11. So row 11 was the lowest performing student in Geometry College Prep. And so that student was 6 questions or 6 points. Some of the questions, the open response questions are worth 4 points. There's maybe about 5 or 6 that are worth 2 points, and the rest are 1 point. But so that question, that person 11 on row 11, that was the lowest performing student in our school in Geometry College Prep. And that person was 6 points from proficient. So access to these two courses is so vitally important. Since you'll notice the last 4 on the list, Algebra 1, Algebra 1, STEM, and Algebra 1. They didn't take Geometry at all. You also probably are wondering, the kids that are in Algebra 1, 4 points from proficient, I sort of wonder about that kid's placement on row 6. Kid is not even in Geometry and is close to being proficient. That's pretty amazing. Wondering if maybe he's potentially misplaced, he or she. Next month, okay, so next month we are going to begin a between both buildings review of the new 2017 math standards and take responsibility for them and advocate or potentially advocate for not teaching a fringe topic. The Department of Education this month published a list of cluster standards to focus on for 2019 for the MCAS in 10th grade, so in 2 years. And many, this is a little bit scary, but many of the standards have never ever been assessed before, so more difficult standards. This change alone, I know, is going to up the challenge of the test, not to mention the fact that it's going to be given on a computer. So standards that, if you were to look at, say, this past year's MCAS, there were about 10 or more questions that line 1 says that in 2000 they were a 10th grade standard. And then the line underneath it says, well, since the Common Core came out, they're considered middle school standards. We've been using those, there's been about 10 of the like 25 to 30 questions that are sort of now middle school standards. That's going away. And so there will only be questions assessed on the 10th grade frameworks. So it's a huge, huge change. So I think statewide, our school scores, we would expect scores to drop in 2019. And that would be one reason why we would want our honors courses, I want our honors courses this year to spend more time on standards-focused work starting this year. Because to be sure, if legacy MCAS was continuing for, you know, from here to eternity, our honors and high honors courses are nearly 100% proficient and mostly advanced. You notice here on this list, of these 15 kids, there is line 2. One student in Geometry honors was 1 point away from proficient, but it's probably like 98-99% of the kids in honors, any honors or high honors course would be proficient or advanced. If legacy MCAS was staying, I think the focus on free response could be a very big positive change. But since legacy MCAS is going away, we need to focus on this more. Okay, next. I think I have 2 more slides. Our goal is for all learners to meet and exceed the expectations on MCAS. And I know we are a high performing and great district, but I also know that MCAS is a very important component of being great. The focus on free response, I've already sort of said this, but will likely help our scores on legacy MCAS, but the change to MCAS 2.0 that's coming in 2019 and that's already come at the middle school, we need to redouble and focus our efforts on 3 important areas that I'm going to end with. So 3 important areas that for success. Because we don't, as this slide says, we don't want MCAS to consume all that we do, because it hasn't really heretofore. But we need to refocus or focus on 3 things. Okay, 3-pronged approach. this is how, in sort of preparing for this presentation and preparing for, you know, what do I want to focus on my goals for the year or for the last, over the last 2 years? And, I've really come to see that the AP program that we have has been successful for these three reasons. So in eight, and I already alluded to it, but we are razor focused on the standards that the College Board puts out and what they want students to know and be able to do. We create sound lessons, and we have authentic experiences in class that are tied to so many elements of reading, writing, and sort of like in discourse. So this has to happen in all of our courses. So first, we've done much of the standards work already. I talked about the learning expectations at the beginning of my presentation. We use results from MCAS exams every year to make adjustments in the curriculum. Mary Lou will outline it for you. We've already had our meetings and meetings with teachers at the middle school talking about where we went wrong, what we did really well. And we do that every year in AP Calculus. Like, I can't tell you how excited I am when I hit refresh on to get the scores for AP Calculus. I want to have that same feeling for the MCAS. Before winter break this year, we're going to review what's most important for the new MCAS 2019 exam for 10th grade. And I'm going to have teachers grades 6th, 7th, 8th, and 10th verify that we're teaching the standards that have been slightly updated. In talking with other department heads, there hasn't been a push to simplify radically the number of standards covered, an idea promoted by researchers like Mike Schmolker and others. One school leader recently told me, we haven't reduced the number of standards that we teach at all. I think I want to head in that direction and focus on problem solving and the process standards. That's the standards of mathematical practice that I plan to really focus on the next few years. Rather than the content standards as much, but we aren't there yet. Another school department had said, we're not opting out of any Common Core standards, but it has taken us a great deal of time transitioning to them. So time is going to tell, as we transition to MCAS 2.0, which questions they assess every year, what the DESE, the assessment people, think is most important. So second part, sound lessons. So Sound lessons is a part of ongoing work, and I'm really working with the teachers on upping the rigor of the tasks, like having more rich tasks that they do in the classroom with their students. Like, how are they using the time with the students to like engage in really meaningful thinking kinds of questions? I believe a few carefully selected and purposeful questions can be very powerful to student learning. And I am going to continue. I'm really big on this. Natalie, you'll see. I knew I was going to do that. Leslie, like, you know how I use the note cards in class? Even just simple note cards, check for understanding, is something that I'm going to continue to push for, however the teachers do it. Seeing in the moment how all kids, do they know or not know something, is something that I just think is an important, an essential component of most lessons, every lesson. In terms of the third part, so literacy. Advice I received from another high-performing department head and a principal in another district told me that really just put the math practices at the center of not only your instruction, but also your assessment. So I believe this is a way for us to have more students meeting or exceeding our expectations in our courses, on MCAS, and it has to be a part of the teacher's everyday practice. And it's not something that I have focused on with the teachers, so it's a real potential for growth for us, focusing on the mathematical practices. So, for example, when students are doing sentence by sentence readings of problems, the math practices would tell students that they need to make sense of problems and persevere in solving them. In their writing and conversations, students need to write viable arguments and critique the reasoning of others. This is something we need to do on a regular basis. So the department time this year and beyond is going to be focused on these practices. Last year at BHS, I explained that time was spent on what we want students to know and be able to do on our learning expectations, and now our work can be focused on how we teach the standards at each grade level. Mr. Griffin, the science department chair or department head, and I are planning a joint 6 through 12 department meeting this January, so next year in 2018. We're gonna have teachers debrief rounds in science and math, rounds of peer observations together, and then we're planning to have the teachers engage in a writing exercise that's focused on sort of rich math and science tasks. I am thankful to have that between building and potential, like between building time in our professional development calendar. So thank you for that. One area I know our students need more practice in is interpreting. I told this to Mary Lou, and there's a clear overlap with science, with interpreting graphs and tables, especially even just that sixth grade problem that I had up on the board at the beginning. And that's at the heart of quantitative literacy. Students need to be able to interpret formulas. They need to be able to make estimations. And I have even in my goals a desire to audit the SAT exam this year. And I feel like these kinds of things, like estimating, reading tables and graphs, it's at the heart of sort of the new SAT. Now, in October of this year, we had another, what I think was a productive grade 6 through 12. We have 4 days during the year where we can bring the two buildings together, and I tend to use them every time. In October, we were talking about goal setting. And one teacher wrote in feedback to me, I like the way that we're doing goals this year, and I appreciate that we're doing things that are really meaningful. This is a quote from the teacher. But the teacher said, my only concern is there isn't much time. So my answer to that teacher would be that this three-pronged approach that I know has been working in AP Calculus, that is rich in literacy and writing and thinking and talking and reading, that's going to be our focus for some time. And if we focus on this, then all students will learn and be prepared to meet and exceed expectations on exams like the MCAS, the SAT, and just be more successful in their math classes at the middle school and at the high school. So this is a lot of work. There's a lot of things that we need to do. I look forward to this work with the students and the teachers, with the principals, and with Mary Lou, and of course with Don. So that's it, and I invite questions, comments, and thanks for having me again.
Thank you so much for this. It's really helpful. Leslie, we'll start with you. Do you have anything you want to say to Mr. Morrison? Morrison?
I think overall, the changes that are being made, the efforts being made to sort of adjust, I guess the issue with the high honors geometry class.
Yeah.
I know that me personally, I heard the talking about your reputation of being like very smart, and I know many of the whole students who sort of didn't go through the geometry high honors class, but still ended up being on the high honors in math course for the rest of their high school career. And I think a lot of students they could manage the geometry high honors with more preparation. I think it's not just the switch. It's not just like the class is hard, but the switch between like middle school math
Leslie, were you in geometry high honors?
I was.
Because I will say that, so Leslie's in my class, and there are two or three kids in my class who I was shocked when I found out they weren't in geometry honors, and I'm thinking like, wow, like what was going on that they when they were going to be freshmen, like there's some students in our class, Leslie, that are some of the really strong students that were in geometry honors for whatever reason. And so I know it's a personal decision. What you're going to do in terms of the course, but I think you're right on it with the transition from middle school to the high school, and so we're working really hard to basically make, when you hear about the academically advanced math class, we're trying to have that be more like the algebra class, so more kids get the challenging algebra experience in the middle school. When you were there, Leslie, were you in the pull-out class, as we would call it then, or were you?
I wasn't on the traditional flat course. Like, I have friends who are sort of on that course for the entire life at Bedford public schools. I was in it for my last 8th grade year. It's more of an accident than anything, but I think I think it did help me, I mean, at least like in terms of, I can't remember what the skills in the class specifically helped me in geometry, but I know that I developed a really good force ed in that class. I was really so challenged by it. And that helped me in geometry.
Ms. Gray.
Well, first I want to thank you for such an informative update. It was fascinating. I mean, you've done so much work in the last year.
Thank you. It's great
to hear. Mm-hmm. You dug down into some deep topics, and I just wanted to share something that you jogged my mind about.
Okay.
Leslie saying she wasn't pulled out or put in that special. One of the things we have to remember is that you send kids a message in third grade when you say, guess what, you don't get to go out. So they get the idea in their head that they're not good in math. It's actually not the case for many of them. But early on, and you could ask kids now who are 4 and 5 years out of Bedford High whether they were in that special math at Davis
right.
or Lane. And I know we need it, and it's wonderful we offer it, but sometimes we need to think about the kids who don't get to go and what we're saying to them. I'd like to think your math destiny isn't determined by third grade. I think the results would support that. But in their heads, they don't see themselves as being good in math, good enough to push. So
I can remember doing an observation either last year or the year before, and a kid, it was in say a seventh grade class, and I sat down next to him. I try to meet one student every time I do an observation, and the student's like, guess what, I want to show you my test. He hadn't made the sort of the cut for the academically advanced. Sure. It was like crushing to him. And yeah, and sort of I asked a teacher about, you know, what was it, and he was sort of on the cusp of the number of kids that they could put in the program, and it was like, it was basically what you're talking about. Or even just this, today, like speaking personally about my daughter, she said, Daddy, can you play with me? And I said, well, I have this really important thing I have to go to tonight, and I gotta take a shower and blah, blah, blah. And she's like, well, can you give me some math problems? And so I gave her some math problems, and then she came back, and she hadn't really done them, and she goes, you're gonna laugh at me. And I'm like, whoa, like, why are you thinking I'm gonna laugh at you? So like, even someone who's 7 years old and in first grade is sort of like forming judgments about how she does, or, you know, how she is with math. And so it's
constantly the message.
The academically advanced math class is a very, you know, it's a controversial topic. And so I'm very hopeful that the message to parents and to students is that we are really working. The teachers have it in their goals to have algebra class. That's, you know, you're preparing to take geometry high honors at the high school. It's what I said in here is true. Like, not any extra topics you'd be doing in would be, you know, sort of like in your own interest that wouldn't necessarily
right.
help you. Like, and so that's
enrichment.
More enrichment, right? Correct. And there's now a directed study for all kids during like the bottom right-hand corner of the schedule, like day six, day period six or something. There's even been talk to potentially have that be for like the super, like the AMC math focused, like the kids who really want to do like competition kinds of things. If there really is that sort of like extra high math need. So it's, you know, that's a very good point to bring up.
Well, I also have to do my true confessions for math, not only because I'm not very strong at it, but I remember one of my kids, maybe my daughter was in the middle school, and they had you do a test mm-hmm. to see whether you would go into the better. And they said, parents, don't help your kids.
So
we didn't help them. And I went to a cocktail party later that week, and the other parents said, oh, we all did it with them.
Yeah.
How could you let your kids do it cold? And I said, oh, well, they told us not to. So anyway,
they all seem fine.
All gone on to fine lives, but it's still painful for me.
Yeah.
So, but enough about me. Anyway, I loved how you went deep into the AP calculus and sort of looking at data and looking at how students are doing, and also knowing that, you know, it can be difficult, but if you do the work, you get the work. That's why I so enjoyed when you came a month ago and had the students present. And even sharing the expectations with the students. This is what you should be able to do.
Mm-hmm.
And seeing that, and seeing the difference. And also just seeing all the kids in geometry high honors. And that they're willing to jump in the deep end. Good for them. You want to see more of that. I often wonder if it would be worthwhile to survey parents some way to find out who's paying tutors and why. And I think parents would share it if they knew where mm-hmm. it was going, and that it wouldn't be any way shared with the students. But it's worth finding out why parents are doing it. Are they doing it just because everybody else does it? They think they have to do it? You know, I was cracking up the other day. I was driving through Lexington, and I'm used to Russian math, and now there's Singapore math. Yep. I almost drove off the road to kind of just go in and say, so what's the difference? Like, what's Singapore math as opposed to Russian math? So obviously there are a lot of choices out there for parents, and so maybe if we found out more why they were doing it. When you look at the academic support models, and I so appreciate that you went and looked and saw what other districts were doing. Is there a particular model that you prefer, if we could do it? I'm just curious. I'm not a math person.
You're asking me?
Yeah.
Well, I think that what I advocated for if we could have more, like I would advocate over time to have more math teachers teach the
available
during like the math support class, you know, for like the push in the model that if you had a math teacher or even someone, even a TA who's really skilled in
math yeah.
who we do have here at the high school, if that person can be available for kids for like coordinated push in, so, you know, sort of service, like especially and for kids in special ed. I think that if we had a coordinated effort as a school to do that, I think that could be very powerful and something that we've been talking about doing that I really want to be a part of if this is going to be a school-wide effort. So, you know, of course, having a math teacher being able to have support during the school day is like the optimal, but a teaching assistant who has math in their background is and is working as a team would be very powerful too.
That would be great.
So.
And also because we know the special ed students haven't done, those are one of the groups that we're trying to help perform better. So, and do we ever, where do the volunteers come from?
So right now the volunteers that we have are just people that heard about us from like last year and called up and I interviewed them. And,
great.
They were quarried and they come from, some have had careers in math and science, like in extraordinary careers at area colleges and so just from the Bedford community.
Have we gotten any from Carlton Willard?
No.
Because I imagine we have quite a few.
So that's another thing I'll advocate for potentially expanding or getting more tutors to help our kids, and that's definitely a place that we could look. There's, I think, word of mouth is really strong too,
good.
and through the Council on Aging too.
The Council on Aging too.
Yeah,
and I so appreciated the MCAS piece, the Dipper Trend, and you dug deep, and I actually understood it, so I was pretty proud.
Oh, okay.
Because sometimes they get a little. And also, just looking at the needs improvement versus the how close they are,
mm-hmm.
and even for the student to hear that. Or even for the couple kids that failed, like you're just so close.
No, the kids that failed were pretty far.
They were
away.
Way off.
They
I'm sorry, the needs like, improvement.
Yeah, the needs improvement were close. Yeah,
I'm sorry, those were the ones. That's what it was.
Yeah.
They weren't that far.
And those kids will all, the ones that are needs improvement don't take the test. No, never mind. I was going to say the kids who oftentimes, you might be wondering, are the kids who fail, do they ever not pass a test? We've always had the kids pass. So I suspect that the two students, they're going to have several opportunities to try to pass the test. Could take a few times.
It's the problem. And then I'm just so excited to hear about the planning between buildings and the 4 days and how well you're using it.
Yeah, thank you.
You know, it's sort of something we wanted to see for a long time. And I'm sure the teachers appreciate it. It's great to see. And good for you for auditing the SAT and seeing what they'll do. I don't really have any questions.
Okay.
Well,
thank you.
Good.
Thank you very much for your presentation. And before I forget, please thank your daughter for allowing us to have.
Oh yeah.
And taking away from her. I just to reiterate what Leslie had said. You know, talk to my daughters who are both in high school about their experience with the math program. One of them said, you know, she participated in the Bedford summer program that couple of weeks at the beginning of the summer. She said she found that was really critical in helping her succeed in math at the high school. So for what that's worth, thank you for starting that program. And the only other concern that I have, it's really very interesting to hear about this. I think I might actually like to go back and take math now. It was not like Anne. Didn't feel it was my strongest point. And this sounds really interesting. I am just a little concerned in the focus on getting all the kids into the high honors geometry, that for the kids who aren't, that's not their thing, that they still feel that they have value and that it's still important for them to work and be motivated in math, even if they're not gonna get to the high honors that, that they're going to develop important skills.
Sometimes I even wonder if the names of our courses is like so high. So yeah. none of the area schools have high, like high honors, I believe, is sort of unique to us. So I often wonder if it was college prep and advanced college prep and honors, would that be different? That's an excellent point. I would think if a kid was going into honor, if it was called honors, maybe there, I don't know, you wouldn't feel like you're like, I don't know, not, if you're in a class that's called honors or high honors, you'd think it was, and you're gonna be able to take Algebra 2 by sophomore year, like that, like kids who are in our honors courses are some of the kids on the AP calculus list for AP calculus. So it's not like being in honors at the high school is not like a piece of cake. It's not, you know, it's the demanding class. Like it's the pre-calculus class that I was, you know, vetting the test for the teachers, because it was, you know, it's demanding. So, but I understand what you're saying. Like, I don't think, I wouldn't hope, this is a good point. Like I wouldn't hope that, and I don't know this, but like, I don't think there's a message at the middle school that's like, hey, we're gonna try to get as many people as, you know, into high honors. I think it's just us knowing that, you know, the class has been a barrier to some students, and we want to sort of take that away, and because we know we have kids sitting in, you know, I didn't show it here, but maybe Mary Lou can, kids that were in geometry honors and then Algebra 2 honors as freshmen and sophomores who are well advanced, way, you know, like you're like, whoa, look at that MCAS score, like, or look at your grades, like you're getting like a 96-97%. You really shouldn't be in, you know, we could challenge you a little bit more. And so that's sort of what we're doing. But I don't, there's no like concerted mess. Like I doubt you the students know that we're even doing any of this work, or, you know, it's just the kids are in Algebra 1 and it's a more challenging class and they don't really know it. But I could be wrong on that. It's a good question.
Okay, yeah, I mean, I haven't heard anything about it from anybody, but it just, in the, that has come through so much in this presentation that I just worry about whether that is coming through to the students, but.
Okay. Every year, Joanne, there's about 15 students who are not in geometry, or not in geometry high honors, who the next year, like our numbers go up with Algebra 2 high honors, because it's sort of the roadblock that I was explaining. Like I personally know students who do it, so we're trying to remove that and allow those, like, you know, this entering class is big to begin with, but we're trying to, you know, with the changes we've made, to allow more kids to start off in the high school in our highest level.
Let me just add a couple things about that, if I may. One is the attention Patrick paid to it tonight is out of proportion to the attention that the department pays to it overall.
Okay.
Only because there's been some controversy about that course, and so he wanted to really address that course here. We are the middle school's creation of the new algebra course at the middle school to ensure that all kids get that opportunity. That's in some ways the bigger story, you know, and that's feeding, you know, the high school, not necessarily to high honors, but to geometry and geometry honors.
Correct.
Okay.
So thanks, John, for saying that. But yeah, that's, I didn't want it to be a big part of the presentation, but it's definitely, I wanted to let people know what, you know, what we've done and what we are doing for this course. But I for sure will follow up. With the eighth grade teachers, there shouldn't be a message to the kids that like, hey, we expect you to be in geometry high honors. Like, we're going to push you no matter what. That has not been my impression, but that, you know, thank you for making me think about that, and I will look into that.
Okay, thank you.
But you said you hadn't heard that from your daughters or
It just in I'm thinking about somebody particular in my family who really struggled with math in high school, and it defined a lot of some of her feelings about herself, and I just don't want to see other children have that experience.
That's why the comment I made about the, you know, are we pushing the kids too much? We monitor kids' grades and our students of concern, and so it's something like a school-wide effort, something that we have talked about really trying to really focus on. You know, this is what we'd want to see. Like, okay, we have a kid that's in Algebra 2 honors as a sophomore, but kids getting a C minus? Like, was this, mm-hmm. is this, it'll probably be good for our MCAS scores, but overall, was this in the best interest of the student? Mm-hmm. So we, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, it's, you know, this is the kids that were in the algebra class that John just mm-hmm. referenced. This is the first time that they're in, you know, they're sophomores now. I call them the vanguard the last time I was here. So we're mm-hmm. we're really paying attention to you know, these kids and seeing the kids that are coming behind them, so.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Thanksgiving.
You too.
Patrick, thanks Michael. For this presentation. You had quite a challenge on your hands.
I did.
In taking
yeah.
over this department, and it's yeah. not, so just to be really blunt about it, it was not an uncontroversial program. And there were parents that had some strong feelings about it. And that goes back way before anyone who works in this district. As someone who grew up here, the math department, and maybe this is, you know, sort of math as a topic, as a subject, as an area of focus. It's not known for being sort of flexible. It's not known for being gray. Mm-hmm. It's not known for any of that. And so that's, I guess, why I really appreciate your approach on this, you're leading with like a kindness and an openness and a support that is uncommon in I think many people's experience with mm-hmm. math departments. Mm-hmm. And it would be, I hope that comes through, that how much we're not mathematicians. And I think we all are bringing our own baggage to a conversation about math.
Yeah.
And I think that was the math department, not just at Bedford, but I think that math class, there are a lot of feelings about that, a lot of strong opinions on it. And I think that wasn't a new concept. And I think that there was growing frustration because people hadn't been getting the responses they were looking for. And they hadn't been getting an openness and a willingness and a flexibility. Or frankly, just a willingness to say, yeah, let me look into that. Mm-hmm. And I think what you've done is you've really just said, let me look into that. And it's not one solution, it's a bunch of solutions. But your approach is so markedly different from what I think a lot of parents were getting for a while. By a while, I mean for like 30 years. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I just appreciate it tremendously because I think that you have a difficult job between the history and between, let's be honest, like a town of engineers,
yeah,
everyone who's
yeah.
got a strong opinion on math, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. and expertise in math. As someone who was a curriculum director, I was a curriculum director of social studies. It was like the best gig going because like no one cared.
You just read the newspaper every day.
You know, like it was just like no one had really strong opinions
That's a joke.
On it. Do you know what I mean? Like it was like, but people had such strong passionate feelings.
I know.
And whether it was passionate for or against, but there was a lot of strong emotion. And I think that I just appreciate tremendously the
Thank
approach
you.
You've taken.
Thank you.
It's refreshing. It feels very honest and it feels really kind. And I haven't always thought of math departments as departments who are really interested in kids getting access. Maybe that's just my impression. But the idea that you're really focusing on all kids getting there is sort of refreshing for me to hear, and I just appreciate it tremendously.
Thank
so thanks
you,
for doing the work the way you've done the work.
That's all I have. Thanks, man. Okay, thank you. And that was a joke about the newspaper.
I just ignored it.
School teachers, they come to school and they have in their briefcase the newspaper.
I ignored it. I was for years of those criticisms. I just kept looking by. Anyways, Patrick, you're off the hook. Thank you for coming
okay.
tonight, and I really appreciate you being here.
Okay.
And have a good Thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Heather, thank you for being here as well. All right. Our next item on the agenda is this capital and operating budgets discussion. review.
Okay, so I just have a couple things to share tonight about the budget. One is just an update on some of the capital items. So the first is that when we presented the school's capital plan or projections for FY19, we included some auditorium upgrades that include lighting, rigging, sound system, et cetera. We were going to spread that out over 3 years, starting with the rigging and the lighting, because there was some safety concerns there. The reality is that there's some pressing need to upgrade the audio for the high school auditorium. Certainly it functions for the high school, but we saw at town meeting that it would be a real service to the town were we to address that. So essentially what we're going to talk to capital expenditures about next week is moving about $40,000 worth of sound improvements from FY20 to FY19. Not to replace the existing item around the rigging and the lighting, because there is a safety concern there, but to add it to it. So essentially makes it about a $75,000 item for FY19 instead of a $35,000-$38,000 item. So just wanted your support for that.
Yep.
To move forward.
So I would just add to that, in light of the experience at Fall Town Meeting, I had a request from many citizens to say we need to do something. You know, it was clear to everyone. So that's why I asked you to sort of consider about moving that. So mm-hmm. I think that is a response to the request that we had.
Makes a lot of sense. This really is not a decision point, I think, but just to kind of surface the issue. And Joanne may be able to speak more to it because she was at the meeting, but there is a item for capital in FY19 to improve the snack shack, whose roof is in terrible disrepair, and at the same time to create a couple of outdoor bathrooms, or not outdoor bathrooms, but a bathroom unit next door to it. And there's the reason for that is both during football games and other events, rec department, the only bathrooms close by are actually in the high school, and we have to pay a custodian just to keep that open. So over time, it's an operating expense that really need not be incurred. So the total cost of that project is about $109,000, and the roof comprises about $20,000 of that total. So I guess there was some discussion about asking all of the users to kind of raise the money or find the money to make that happen. My own feeling is that the bathrooms really are a town responsibility. It's no different than any other capital item, that it serves a broad population, even if it just serves the school. That's a major capital expenditure. The repair of the snack shack roof, because the snack shack has been used historically by Palms, they actually make money, which they use philanthropically for the music program, and they always give something back to the high school for the athletic program, which resolved an old controversy about whether they should be the exclusive users during football games. I don't see a reason why those who use it couldn't contribute to that. About $20,000 split up in different ways, but I don't know if Joanne, if you have some more information about that.
I think that you covered it pretty well. One thing that it seems to me that would add to how to divide it up, and it was something that we had talked a little bit about at the time last year when we were trying to get the funding for the elevator to the press box. Is I don't know that, does anybody know how much that area is used by different groups? How much is for school events and how much for, you know?
I don't have that answer, but I think before we go to Kaplan, I should get that information. Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, I'm not expecting to have the answer.
I do.
No, I'm sorry. Palms does make generous donations to the school music programs, and you know, I think that it makes some sense to look at how to allocate expense.
So can I make the observation for that size roof, $20,000 feels like a lot of money. So I don't know where that estimate came from. So that's my first thought. My second thought is, we own it now. It's not a new property. It wasn't like someone said, "I'll give you the shack, but we're not going to build the roof." We've had it for a long time. Mm-hmm. It's part of our facility, and therefore we should maintain it as we maintain the facility. That's strictly my take. Mm-hmm. It's nice when outside groups offset our costs, but offsetting our costs for programming and offsetting our costs for maintenance feels like two very different things.
Right.
You know, if we want Palms to go buy a tuba or a keyboard, that to me feels like, you know, a nice thing that's adding to our program. I don't think that money that people gave to outside organizations with the intent of helping students, that's the spirit which people give money to, right? They give money to Palms hoping music will be enriched. To have, even if Palms was to use that for roofing, to me it would feel like there would be a risk to them then reducing the amount of money that they were going to get in the future, because if they were spending on roofs and bathrooms, I wouldn't give to that organization, just me personally. And I think that putting them in that position feels a little bit unfair. So I guess we can ask for donations, but I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of these organizations said, we're not in the roofing business, we're in the children business, mm-hmm. and our money goes towards children, and that's the commitment we make. So. To me, this fits firmly in maintenance of a facility, and also I think it could probably be closer to $10,000 than $20,000.
Well, the other suggestion that I made, I don't know if, I'm assuming somebody from CapEx looked into this, is the possibility of asking Shawshing Tech to take on the roof as if the town pays for supplies.
That'd be great.
Mm. I'm talking to the Shawshing Tech superintendent next week, so I'll see if he'd be interested.
Okay. Any thoughts on that, the roof?
I have to echo Mike's concerns, and I worry too if we go to Palms and say we want you to pay for it, I understand we'd want to obviously go in and say, look, we've done all we can, we've looked under all the bushes, we found money, but it's ours, we own it, we got to fix the roof.
I'm sorry. So what Palms said they raised for a year, $6,000 from that. So even if all they did was replace the roof, that'd be 3 years of mm-hmm. every other proceeds going.
Good point.
That's a lot of Skittles.
Yes.
All right. Thank you. Next item.
Thank you. So this is the annual 10,000-foot preview, which I will, after sharing with you, getting your questions and feedback, present. This will be at Finance Committee on November 30th. This is, to be clear, this is a projection of what our maintenance of effort budget is, which
Can
is-
Can you just define maintenance of effort again, Joe? For those that don't know it?
Which is, the level of funding that is attached to meeting all of our mandates, all of our contractual obligations, and maintaining the basic level of service that we are committed to, without expansion items, without adding new staff.
Is that to say that to offer the same program that we currently offer in next year's money, what it would cost?
Yes.
Okay. Not anything new?
Correct.
Not any changing needs, not addressing anything upcoming?
Absolutely. So we estimate what our maintenance of effort amount will be to do that going forward. And then we have calculated what it would cost were we to meet all of the needs that we've identified. And needs always are on a gradient of high need to, you know, really would like to have, but maybe can wait a year. So these are just very general figures at this point to give us some parameters. So I want to start by saying that, like last year, our special education situation is always very fluid, and particularly in terms of the students who are out of district, who either come back to district, who age out, who leave the district, or who are kids who are presently in district who need to be sent out. That fluctuates through the year, and it's actually very hard to predict. Last year, we had a number of kids net to come in, and we had to add staff after the budget had been approved. This year, we actually have a net loss of students after the budget was formed, which creates a different condition, and it coincides with some very important information that came to us through a consultant that reviewed our bridge program and made some very important recommendations about how we have organized the bridge program, which is our program at Lane, JGMS, and the high school for students with strong social emotional challenges, and that have staffing implications. And the recommendation is that we actually add some therapeutic staff and some teaching staff to the bridge program across the district this year. So we're in a position to actually to do that, and I'll come forward with some specific figures, but we're looking at several FTE that would not impact the budget, because the net of about four kids who we did not expect to no longer be on our rosters outplaced would certainly cover the cost. So we entered, FY 17 with 59 out of district students. Four aged out at the very end. So we entered FY 18 with 55 out of district students. 12 have exited since then, since July 1st, either graduating, leaving the district, returning to district schools, coming back to Bedford schools. And then we've had eight additional outplacements, either kids that moved in that we had no way to predict, or some students whose education plans require that we move them because we were not able to meet their needs. So that's a net of four students fewer than we had planned for. So we think that that would basically cover the costs of some added FTE. There would be some added cost to the town in benefits, but by next week I'll have the specifics on that.
So, can I just add to this that this is why school budgets are built the way they're built? Because it's about changing needs by the day. You might get triplets move in, and you might get triplets move out, or whatever it is. And I think that's hard for people who don't understand school budgets, because people always want to put like a pin in exactly what that number is going to be. But we know the ones who are aging out; those are the easy ones. We know the ones who are graduating, but. You know, new IEPs, changing circumstances. You just
kids are graduating.
Yeah, that could be too, right?
They're yours till they're 20.
My point is that this is not a result of poor projection and poor budgeting. This is a result of changing student needs that there's no way to predict. And the good news is that we have a budget that allows us to have that flexibility.
Absolutely. So David's done a lot of work over the last couple weeks and estimates that our maintenance of effort budget, again, what it, what's required to do what we're doing in inflationary costs and with the contract, et cetera, would be an increase of 2.68% over the approved FY18 budget. So the approved FY18 budget is $39,061,561. The additional cost to maintain our programs would be $1,048,360. So the overall maintenance effort budget is $40.1 million. Our enrollment, you know, we've actually shown our enrollment out to 25, and it climbs considerably from 2021, 21, 22. But for the purpose of budgeting, we thought we would just give the next several years. And as you can see, our numbers, kindergarten, they had hit this high point back in 2012. They're going up and down a little bit, but they're staying relatively steady. I think the important thing that has ramifications for this coming year is that our grades 3 through 5 are going to have 640 odd students, which we certainly never had that I remember at Lane School. And then again, even by 2021, JGMS will grow considerably. I'll give you the aggregates in a moment, but I just want to give you a sense of what the grade changes are. So in aggregate, Davis, 615, 607, we expect it to go up next year. JGMS, where we had thought we would have several years before it really began to climb, made a significant jump, little dip there, but it's climbing, and we'll hit a high point in 2021-22 of 653, and it goes beyond that. The high school, which has dipped for a year or two, is climbing back up. We'll be close to 900 again in 21-22. And you can see that there's essentially 300 students district-wide have increased over the, what will be a 5-6 year period.
John, what accounts for the BHS between 2021 and 21-22 from 834 to 899? That is a huge jump. And you may not know the answer, because I know these things are not really, like, you can't pin at that, but do we know what that jump?
A lot of this Davis and Lane over the last few years, or jumped out of the 200s, they're all going to start hitting, and then that Hanscom piece traditionally has been 120% of our eighth grade, or thereabouts. So there is a big, potential big jump. Yep. Again, that's completely out of our hands.
Yep. When you get four classes with 220 kids or so in them, plus the Hanscom kids.
So and then that very small class that's now freshmen, they'll graduate at 21.
Right. Yeah, and then it'll be steady all in the 200s.
Great, thank you.
David calculated just the class size projections, and as you can see, and this has been on our mind because of the Davis School Building Project, that in 21 and 22, you know, we probably by that time will need to go up to the 10 classrooms in K1 and 2, which we are building for. And then we will be pretty much at our maxes for kindergarten, first and second grade. You know, because our maxes for Lane School is 24, we can get by probably with 9 classes for fourth and fifth grade and still have a decent average. But again, we've built Lane for that capacity. So with that enrollment in mind, we will need an additional classroom teacher at Lane School to meet that enrollment projection. With those increased numbers at JGMS, we have the need for a foreign language teacher who would do some Spanish and some French. Our kindergartens, which, you know, even though we hopefully, once the Davis School is finished, but it won't be finished next year, so we continue to have 10 classrooms worth of kids in 9 classrooms, and we have that extra teacher, but we would really like to move our EAs, who are 0.8 to 1.0, so that they can be in the classroom the whole time. Right now, they can't be in the classroom the whole time.
Can I just clarify that? Is that all EAs from 0.8 to 1.0?
It would be the 9 EAs.
No, it's currently just the EAs. The only 0.8 EAs we have are the kindergarten EAs.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
So it's only...
But it's all classrooms, all kindergarten classrooms who have a 0.8 EA currently.
Six of them total.
Oh, there's only 6.
Yeah, there's only 6 that don't have
a 1.0. Okay.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Special education, our expectation is that if we're able to meet those needs this year, we'll only have about $15,000-$20,000 of additional ESY work with kids. And then we have some additional instructional needs that have kind of percolated looking at how our kids are doing at Davis and BHS. We need some additional, I'm sorry, this should be Lane, not Davis. 0.5 reading at Lane, 0.5 reading at BHS. We presently split an instructional technology specialist between Davis and Lane. We'd like to add another instructional so there can be a dedicated person at both school. Our teachers are starting to do lots of work with their iPads and with their Chromebooks, and they can only be as good as they have the professional development to learn how to use those things well. And we have a computer tech who maintains the computer lab at Lane, but he's only part-time, and we'd like to add a 0.2 there. So the budget impact, based on enrollment, special education, instruction, were we to do all of these things, it'd be $349,000. Our additional personnel needs have to do with having added space at Lane. And we had asked, for a full-time custodian. I think we only got a half-time last year in order to kind of meet the guidelines that we tried to meet. So we still have, we don't have sufficient custodians to keep the schools at a level of cleanliness that we are committed to, given all the square footage. And you know, we have, just because of having a large unit and there's regular absenteeism, our OT costs are quite high, so having a dedicated person to offset these costs would actually be economically efficient in the long run. Similarly, with our additional space and our maintenance needs, we could use a second licensed technician for HVAC. And in order to kind of secure optimum work across all 4 schools for our custodian staff, we'd like to add a stipend of a 4-person. That's about a $4,000 stipend to help to keep that organized. So the budget impact of that second tier of personnel would be about $110,000. And then when we add up what our projected needs are in terms of maintaining and kind of modestly expanding our technology, particularly at Lane, Davis, and JGMS, with a combination of iPads and Chromebooks. The Chromebooks have become really popular. It was a great move. We are piloting our learning management system this year, just a small pilot, and this is that data warehousing and analytics program that will allow us to really track kids' progress K through 12, also eventually house digital portfolios for all kids, and we've started to build those portfolios now. So we'd like to continue to invest in that. Our Reader's Workshop approach to teaching literacy as effectively as possible at Lane School has some pretty expensive materials, about $45,000 worth of booklets and books and readers. We'd like to expand the calculus project that you've heard about, and then when we add the various equipment and software, that budget impact, non-personnel, is about $135,000. So the total expansion budget, if you were to do everything, amounts to about $594,000 or 1.52%.
OK. Can I ask about the iPads, Chromebooks? What's the difference between these ones and the ones that we get out of Capital?
We don't get these out of Capital, so we get desktops and laptops out of Capital. The iPads are leased, and the Chromebooks are very modestly priced. So we've been buying some carts of those.
Okay.
And they don't last as long because they're very poor.
So Capital just does desktops and laptops?
Desktops, laptops, and then, you know, the projectors. And
right. And could it do iPads or Chromebooks, or that's just not
Couldn't do the leases, which is the only economical way to do the iPads.
And they were, we looked at it when we first started this. The determination was that the iPad didn't really qualify as a computing device mm-hmm. the way that a laptop does because of its limitations, but also its general cost and its lifespan.
Mm-hmm.
It really doesn't have, it's just not the same thing.
Mm-hmm. So. Thank you.
So, this is the estimated projected roll-up. Where now we have both the maintenance of effort line, salary, $1.2 million, non-salary, and this has gone down partly because of what our projections are around special ed, continuing to derive some benefits from our in-house programs. So our total maintenance of effort, again, $1.04 million or 2.68. And then when we look over at our expansion, personnel is about 1.4, the non-salary 1.79. Of course, since this is a much smaller component of the overall budget, 7 million compared to 33 million, the average comes down to 1.52 when you combine them for expansion. So the total for next year, were we to do this, would be 4.2%.
So just to restate that, I want to make sure I have it right. The maintenance of effort budget is an increase of 2.68%.
Correct.
Which just meets current needs.
Correct.
So in other words, if you were to buy the same groceries today, next year, what would it cost you? The increase, if we were to add those expanded items, it would be an increase of 4.2% projected right now.
Altogether.
Yep. Perfect. Just want to make sure I have it right in my head. Thank you for that. That's helpful. And again, to remember that this is a 10,000-foot view. This is like this is an overarching view. There's a lot of specifics, a lot of logistics to get into. But this is how the budget process begins, that we talk about what are the major drivers. Enrollment's a driver. Special education changes are drivers. Transportation are drivers. Those are sort of the big items. Okay, great. Thank you. We'll start with Leslie. Do you have any questions? You got to have some questions. No, I'm only kidding. Ann?
Just a question. As the numbers of students who have out-of-district placements, are we at a point yet? I mean, there are still students moving into town who already have them, so they get to keep them, correct?
In terms of their placement?
Yeah, so you have a student at NEC who moves into Bedford.
If they move into Bedford, they stay put until there's...
They may stay forever.
Right.
Yeah.
Because we're not sending many kids out anymore because we're creating all of these programs in-house,
right.
Correct?
Hopefully, you're as kids sort of particularly out of, you know, they either age out or they do graduate or they mm-hmm. move out, whatever. But we're able to keep more of them in. Hopefully, you've had that function. And you don't have a lot of kids moving in and with placements outside of...
A couple of years.
But we do, I mean, there are three kids right now being considered to be placed out who have been with us for a while that we just don't think we're, even with our programs, that we can serve their needs.
And just looking, it's 10,000 feet and we'll do a lot more, but I think the suggestions on special ed is low. I just think we're going to need more. We'll see.
You mean that there aren't FTE? Projected for
right, the 50 or the summer person. I mean, that's really given that we're building all these programs and doing all these co-teach models and everything. It just seems a little low, but we'll see. It's good to get started. So thank you.
Joanne.
I don't think that I have any questions at this point. I will save them for when we get more into the weeds. But thank you for
sure.
Thank you for preparing.
I asked all my questions during, so thank you for that. Any other final comments?
No, I will. I will send you all a memo with the specific number of teachers that we'd like to add for the bridge program this year, and then I will share that also with Finance Committee, because we'd actually like to move quickly on that. Mm-hmm.
Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Up next, David, I want to give you a chance. Are there any other items you want to discuss on the budget?
No, it's evolving. There's, we're still tracking things that we do towards the end of this process, like ERI for retirees. And just, you know, there are a lot of the things that we have to assume at this point that clarify themselves over the next month or two. Mm-hmm. Tuition rates. All of those things, especially with special ed, you finalize it. Are there, you know, if we hit three kids today, 18 yep. is one thing, but that, you know, that full boat is 19.
Yep.
And then you have to think about what's, you know, what else do you know? And then you're still 6 months, 7 months
so
out from doing
it. When we say this is a 10,000 foot view, this is actually a 10,000 foot view as of November 21st.
Right.
All right. Good point.
All right, perfect. Superintendent's report.
Just a couple things. One is we have a generous parent, a graduate, and a present Bedford High School student who has a ping pong table that she would like to donate. It's worth about $500. Mrs. Lorielli Nui, and just like your approval of a donation of $500 of a ping pong table.
Do we know what we're going to do with said ping pong?
Oh yeah, there's a ping pong club and there's a group at the high school that are dying to have it.
All right. In that case, I will accept the motion from any member of the committee to accept a $500 valued ping pong table for the ping pong club.
So moved.
And moves,
I'll
Joanne.
Second.
Any final comments on the ping pong?
So just to the issues that we spoke about earlier with POMS, I, you know, this is something that if we accept it, that at some point we may need to budget to replace it.
Oh, great comment. So if the net breaks, we can't go back to the donor and tell them they owe us a net.
That's right.
Good call. All right. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed, say no. That is approved. And please express our thank you to the family for donating. It's very kind of them. That is approved 3-0.
Just like to share with you briefly how our teachers were engaged in professional learning on last Monday. As the town knows, we have several days during the year where the students are not in school, but the teachers are working, and they're engaged in professional learning experiences. I'm just so proud of the work that our schools are doing around this, and I'll just give you a snapshot. As you know, we have a district-wide focus on literacy that we've launched, and so it's not surprising that all four schools, in one iteration or another, the professional learning focused on literacy. But interestingly, what several of the schools did is that they combined the work on literacy with some work on community building and team building, because we believe as a district, one of our goals, is strategic goals, is collaborative professional culture, and that you have to be deliberate in creating that. And so, for example, at the high school, where the content had to do with providing teachers with opportunities to put themselves in the mindset of students who go from class to class, which means from subject to subject, and have to actually grapple with material that has very different literary structures, very different literary language, and they bring to that very different learning styles. And so that's not always easy to be able to understand everything. And our teachers, several of our staff members, created a massive treasure hunt where teams of high school teachers spent several hours having to search and find clues that were all kind of academic clues where they had to rely on each other and each other's expertise to figure out these very challenging clues. And then when they debriefed, really talked about what it was like as learners. And then they transitioned into some more specific work around what we call disciplinary literacy, where they're looking at the literary structures for different disciplines and how we can leverage that to help kids become more adept readers of complex text. So that was at the high school. At Davis School, the teachers engaged again in a kind of a community building opportunity to look at their own collaboration styles and how kids, because we're very deliberate at Davis at creating opportunities for kids to work together and to learn to work together, and that's done in a very planful way. And so they create an opportunity for the teachers to look at their interactive styles and how you have to be thoughtful about that if you're going to make the whole group work. And then they transition to some really intensive work or in their grade level teams around their integrated curricular units, which are all based on inquiry and engaging kids in literacy in that way. Lane School, which has adopted some very specific reading programs, and I just mentioned one of them. But as you know, one of the ways in which we assess kids at Davis School is through a program called Running Records, where teachers actually sit with kids, listen to them read, and do an analysis of their strengths and weaknesses, not just around fluency, but around comprehension at the same time. And we've moved that program up into Lane School over the last few years. And so Andrea Salaponte, our reading expert and our ELA coordinator for Davis and Lane, did an intensive workshop that was very hands-on around those skills. And finally, for JGMS, which actually used a few hours in the morning with their team conferences for parents, which the parents love, which they've instituted a few years ago, Mr. Tracy had assigned some readings around literacy and also engaged them in some kind of workshop activities, again, around disciplinary literacy. So all four schools reported that it was a great day. I think our PTOs, our PTAs, I think in every school, but fed our teachers, which is always appreciated, and the teachers love being taken care of that way. So great day.
All of which is to say that even though students were off, teachers were not, and work continued, and it turns out it was a good use of money.
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you. And there's a lot of districts that don't have those days, and I think that they're not always better off for that. Their budget might be better, but I think that they lose out on a lot of professional learning and collaboration. That's the key to doing the work. So I'm glad to see that happened. Thank you. All right, on to minutes. I will accept a motion from any member of the committee to approve the minutes of October 10th, 2017.
So moved.
Joanne moves. Do I have a second?
Second.
Ann is the second. So Ann, any comments from you?
Unfortunately, I left mine in the car, so I'm not able to.
So they were good.
Joanne. Perfect.
I'm just double checking. I don't believe I had any changes to the minutes. Nope.
And I did not have any changes in the minutes. So with that said, we'll take a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any abstentions? Any noes? Okay. That is approved 3-0. Nance, your chance of getting 100% on these when Dan is gone is significantly higher. I will accept a motion from any member of the committee to approve the school committee minutes of October 17th, 2017.
So moved.
Joanne moves. Second?
Second.
Ann seconds. Ann, any comments?
None.
Joanne, any comments?
No.
None for me. With that, we'll take a vote. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any noes? Any abstentions? That is approved 3-0. I believe that was all the minutes we had. Is that accurate?
Yes.
Great. With that, I will accept a motion from any member of the committee to close session for tonight. To adjourn. Sorry, that's the word.
So moved.
Joanne moves.
Second.
And seconds. To do so, we will do via a roll call vote. Ann Gway.
Yes.
Joanne Santiago.
Yes.
And I am a yes. We are out of session at 9:26 p.m. Happy Thanksgiving, Bedford, and thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.